Thank you, panelists, for the engaging discussion. The next panel discussion, Deconstructing History, How Do We Arrive at Who We Are, will be moderated by Dr. P K Basu, President of the India Fund. Joining him on the panel are Romesh Gunesekera. His first novel, Reef, was a finalist in the Man Booker Prize. His second novel, The Sand Glass, was awarded the inaugural BBC Asia Award for achievement in writing and literature. Next up, we have Nisid Hajari. He's the Asia editor for Bloomberg View. His recently released debut history, Midnight's Furies, The Deadly Legacy of India's Partition, has attracted critical acclaim globally, including the New York Review of Books, The Wall Street Journal, The Economist, Vanity Fair, and Time Magazine. And lastly, we have Nury, Vittachi. He's one of Asia's most prolific authors and writers, more than 40 books, including the celebrated Feng Shui Detective series of comedy crime novels. He teaches at Hong Kong Polytechnic University and is a senior journalist whose columns are published in leading global publications. I will now pass the floor to Dr. P.K. Basu.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I'm really quite overwhelmed by this extremely talented panel that I'm moderating. Thank you, first of all, for conferring the doctor on me. I don't quite have that yet. But I am writing a book myself. It's in the publication phase. So my father, who's the only one apart from my publisher who read it, says I deserve a PhD. So, okay, at least. But of course, my book is not academic. I don't want it to be academic. It's a history book, but for a wide audience. It is history that we'll be talking about and attempting to deconstruct here. And it's quite interesting that. On this panel, we have two people of Sri Lankan descent. So I will start with Sri Lanka, given that the other panels so far haven't touched too much on it. Although Nury Vittachi is somebody that I started reading when I was not even quite a teenager.
Get you for that.
His Five City Economic Review was a wonderful magazine, and set this central section of it. You had a huge dose of fun through the Vittachi's book. So I haven't read his contemporary novels, I'm afraid, but I'm sure there'll be a great deal of humor in the rest of the session as we get to him. But let me start with Sri Lanka and Romesh Gunesekera's wonderful works. I'd like to just start with S.W.R.D. Bandaranaike. This is a very interesting person who was called Solomon West Ridgway Dias Bandaranaike. Bandar Nayaka is basically, that was translates to the Nayak, or the leader of the port. But he had a name of Solomon West Ridgway Dias. And Sri Lanka's history, of course, is 450 years of colonialism, 150 years each, more or less, of Portuguese, Dutch, and English. And I think all of that was represented in that name. Solomon West Ridgway Dias. And he belonged to a family that was a Mahamudaliyas, the family that negotiated between the Sinhalas and the British. And then S.W.R.D. himself became a Buddhist Sinhala nationalist and perhaps a chauvinist.
Oxbridge educated.
And so, he, of course, was a High Church Anglican at birth and became a Buddhist, and ultimately was assassinated by a Buddhist monk. So identity, history was all very much part of it. And of course, his national movement was based on the idea that he was Buddhagamini, the great mythological figure of the Sinhalas who defeated the king of the Tamils. And we started the session, Ambassador Pillai talked about Ravan, and we're not quite sure whether Ravan was Tamil or Sinhala. So I think that, you know, we can begin with that, and a lot of your early works, Monkfish Moon, all the wonderful stories, and Novel Reef are based on Sri Lankan history. So how does history sort of influence you and remain so part of you, despite the fact that you grew up in Manila and have lived all over the world, and mainly London?
Okay, well, thank you very much for that and for bringing us all on stage. It's very clear to me that the main Sri Lankan on stage is you. since actually you know much more about it than I do, and I suspect even Nury does. And it just reminded me that a small passage that of a book that I did write called The Match, which is a lot about ideas of identity at one level, but actually it's just about boy growing up. But there's a cricket match in there where, based on actually a real cricket match, where India's playing Sri Lanka. And I think, you know, Moni mentioned how we are all eavesdroppers, and that's absolutely true, as writers you are eavesdropping. Which makes all of you writers, because you're actually listening to us talking all sorts of nonsense. But in a cricket match, if India's playing Sri Lanka, you don't have to eavesdrop because it's still drummed into you what everyone's saying. And there are these wonderful chants that start up. And the chant that ended up in my book actually is based on a real one, which is where there's a big discussion going on in the terrace, in the rows. And I can't remember at that particular moment who was playing, but I think Tendulkar was certainly there. But somebody was having a discussion about who are you supporting. And there were very few Sri Lankan supporters where I happened to be sitting, a lot of Indian supporters. And the chant went up about, you know, about who is an Indian and who's the great hero. And eventually, you know, if you ever have a look at the book, you'll see this chart where it starts off one way, but then there's an Englishman there who says he supports India. So this young man starts chanting out. This man's name was Hutton. Hutton is an Indian! Hutton is an Indian! And then it goes on to, you know, all the famous people like Boris Becker, tennis player, is an Indian! Is an Indian! And then you remember Tim Henman, who was always trying to win Wimbledon. You know, the chant went up, Henman is an Indian, Henman is an Indian. And then of course the Sri Lankan batsman hits the six, and everyone says, everyone's a Sri Lankan. So everybody changed identity because everybody just wanted to have a cheer. And identities are very, very fluid. So in that sense, you are the Sri Lankan here. And it's quite interesting that you brought up Bandaranaike, Bandaranaike, because one of the things he said, and it's quite interesting, this transformation he made from Oxford educated. I mean, it's a lot of things that, you know, happened in India as well. But we were talking about language earlier on, and one of the things that he said to one of his colleagues when they were discussing the whole issue of language policy in Sri Lanka, in Salon as it was then, in the 50s, where language policy changed, and as a result, I think it had very far-reaching negative effects, where communities really didn't learn each other's languages. But the reason language became such an issue is because, as a politician, he realized that it was a hugely emotional issue. And basically what he said to his, somebody asked him, why are you stirring this up? And he said, well, there's nothing like language policy to stir people up. And he needed to get a lot of emotion out there. But your question about history, we'll pass on in a moment. History, I don't know. I mean, as a writer, I'm not really trying to work out some huge, big thing, you know. As a writer, I'm always amazed at how so many writers actually do have things they want to express, the things they want to explore, and so on. I actually don't have any of that. I mean, I'm just trying to work out how I write one sentence and how I write another sentence that might follow from that. And then you build up a world, and whether it has any connection with any other world, I'm not sure. But history is important. I think it was George Orwell who said, you know, it's the past that controls the future. But he also said, it's the present rulers who try to control the past because they want to control the future.
Perhaps I can move on to Nisid, who's actually written a book of history. As a journalist, the book is full of wonderful little anecdotes that even those of us who think we know a lot about the history of the partition are surprised by. So full of wonderful little anecdotes,
okay.
But it is in fact a work of history. So he's not deconstructing, but he is creating a new history with a lot of focus on the personalities of two people, Jinnah and Nehru.
It the first question you get when you tell someone that you're writing a history of partition is why. We know this. Don't we know the story already? Hasn't it been told before? Is it everyone's been through these archives a million times? And you sort of have to put that out of your mind very quickly. You'll never get beyond that second sentence, as it were. But when you dig into these things, you find, as you say, that there's so much more there that doesn't make it into the traditional narratives, doesn't even make it into the peripheral narratives, because people are looking at different places. And what I was trying to do with this book was not necessarily tell a history of how the subcontinent came to be partitioned. That's a very familiar story, the negotiations with the British and the sort of 30-year freedom struggle that led up to this moment. And I wasn't even trying to tell the story necessarily of why these terrible traumatic riots broke out upon independence, which as violent as they were and as widespread as they were, still only lasted about 6 weeks. I mean, it was a very condensed time frame that you're talking about for the bulk of them. There's more before and after. But what interested me was the implications of this history. How did this event, or the events of these months, lead to a situation where you have, which was what we started out the day with, these two countries that have so much in common, that at that moment of birth, there are no two countries on the planet that have more in common with each other than India and Pakistan. How have we gotten in a situation where 7 years later, you still have this terrible divide, you still have more than 90% of the people on both sides of the border were born after partition, and yet polls still show that two-thirds of them look with suspicion upon the other country. I mean, there's something fundamentally scary about that. And so when I came at this history, what I wanted to find out was what happened then that made this possible, made it inevitable. It wasn't just the fact that you divided, it wasn't just the fact that there were riots. What were the decisions made? What were the sort of pressures on the leaders on both sides at that time that led them to actions that would drive their countries apart? And when you came at it from that way, all sorts of new information came up, new insights, new players that weren't sort of included in the traditional narratives of partition. So I thought it was worth exploring.
If I could just quickly move on to Nury, you write a lot about identity in a humorous way in all your columns. But there's also a slightly serious element in some of that when it addresses current affairs and contemporary issues. So how has history and your participation in the ongoing history in Hong Kong shaped the way you've written?
Well, PK, I'm not going to be angry about the fact that you've been reading me since you were in the prank. But I just want to say that this is a university event, so we could perhaps arrange for him to have a doctorate to bring the program to area of truth. Actually, history is in language. Our language is so much hidden history in there. You know, Hong Kong, you mentioned that. And I complain about Hong Kong because it's so uncreative. Just look at the words. What is the central business district of Hong Kong called? Central. If you Google map Central, the building in the middle is called Central Building. You know, talk about uncreative. Opposite Central Building is a tower called Central Tower. There's a building in Hong Kong called Skyscraper. Right? Everybody's got Skyscraper, but Hong Kong has a building called Skyscraper. Just occasionally, we get creative. We say, let us use an adjective like those writer types. And so we have a building called Greenish Building, which is white. We have a building called Newish Building, which is very old. I used to, next to the Far East Economic Review was a restaurant called a quite good Chinese restaurant. And you go in there and pick up the menu, and the top of the menu is the signature dish of the restaurant, quite good noodles. And they're quite good is the best you could say about them because they were not great. My favorite vegetarian restaurant in Hong Kong was in Stanley Street, and can you guess the name of it? Vegetarian restaurant. You go in there, and all the waitresses have a name tag just here. And the name tag says, waitress. It serves to differentiate the girls from the fish and the plants and the furniture. You know, so language has our history in there. When I first wrote The Famous Red Detective, it was set in Singapore because I was in so much trouble with the government there. I was sure to be thrown out of Hong Kong. So I switched the destiny, the location of my novel to Singapore, thinking if I get thrown out of Hong Kong, I can go and live in Singapore. You know, I'm the only person in history who thought about coming to Singapore for freedom or trust. I asked my writer friends, okay, I'm going to say this one in Singapore, what do I do? And they said, you add la to the end of every sentence. So, but, you know, I'm a great believer in language, you know, having hidden history. So I came to Singapore and somebody said earlier about eavesdropping. I think it was Moni. So true. I tape recorded hundreds of Singaporeans, usually without asking, and analyzed the writing and the speech. And you don't actually put la on the end of every sentence. I actually found is it was more common than la. You know, hungry is it? Nice weather is it? You know, and I also found that Singaporeans speak in two-word sentences, like so how, where got, toilet, toilet. So two words was like a maximum a Singaporean can use in a sentence. But another thing I've done, I mean, to focus on South Asian theme, I was editing a piece by a Chinese writer, and it said, I bought a catty of vegetables to have with my congee. Okay, now the English publisher said, oh, you can't have these Chinese words in there, catty, congee, change it to pound of vegetables to have with my rice gruel. And the Chinese author was very irate, said, but catty is English. We say cun for a pound of vegetables. And congee is English. We say jok for rice gruel. You know, and it was interesting. People thought, all the Chinese thought kati and kanji were English, and all the English thought kati and kanji were English or Chinese. I started to make a list of words that Chinese people thought were English, and English people thought were Chinese. The list was so long. Coolie, all the Chinese think, well, that's an English word for a guy who carries stuff. Pagoda, Chinese people think, oh, that's a Western word for like a tall building. Palanquin, Mandarin, these are all words that the Chinese think are English and the English think are Chinese. You know where they come from, don't you? They're all words which have come from the Indian languages, some Hindi, some Malay, some Tamil, but they're all words from South Asia that the Chinese think are Indian, the Indians, the English are, the Chinese think they're English, the English think they're Chinese. Even the Bund in Shanghai is, Bund is an Indian word meaning riverbank. It makes sense in Indian, but not in Chinese or English. So it's those individual words that we use today that we have our history in.
Well, that was just wonderful, actually. Mandarin is Mantri. So anyway, perhaps we can go on to sort of segue into another theme that perhaps unites all three of your works to some degree, and that is the pervasive influence of colonialism and colonial history in our lives and our, therefore in your works. So perhaps, Nisid, since yours is a history book, I think the one aspect that you explore somewhat less of is British grand strategy and partition as being something that the British wanted as the outcome.
Yeah, no, I've heard this comment a lot about the book, and the reason I don't explore it because the British didn't want it. You have this sort of, this is what I mean when I say people feel they know partition and you know, they know the story, and then you start to talk about what actually happened. The British at the moment of partition very clearly wanted a united, free India that would be a stable ally in the Cold War that was then starting. Now, you can say that Churchill earlier on favored Pakistan, and even at that time he did, but he was the opposition leader, he had no control over this. There were some British generals who felt that Pakistan could provide bases, air bases against to use against the Soviets, and who felt they were would be a more trustworthy ally than the United India. But the chiefs of staff of the British military, the official position was that they didn't like this. And you can go back and say, of course, that there were many things that the British did in history leading up to this moment that helped divide the communities within India. Obviously, separate electorates during the war. When the Congress leaders were in prison, Churchill and the Tories did sort of help elevate Jinnah into a more powerful position that he had before, and in that sense gave him a platform, gave a much wider audience to the Pakistan demand than it would have had. I think that there was an interesting turning point that most people don't focus on, and maybe I do because I grew up in the U.S., but in 1942, there was a moment where FDR in the U.S. was putting a great deal of pressure on Churchill to grant freedom to Indians, not immediately, but after the war, to lay it out very specifically that if you fight for us now, this is what will happen when the war is over. And the U.S. had just done this with the Philippines and kept their promise after the war. And Churchill pushed back. He was very irrational on this subject. Even his own members of his cabinet thought he was crazy about it, but they were just too scared to bring it up because every time they brought it up, he would give them an incredible tongue lashing in the cabinet meeting, and they were too scared to bring it up again. FDR pushed very hard, and Churchill at one point got very drunk, which he was doing quite often then, and sent a telegram to FDR saying, "Fine, if you want India, you can have it, and I will resign." And this was at a moment when they were just starting to talk about the Normandy invasion and so on. And FDR decided that that was more important than India, and he let it go. So, I mean, all this is to say that you know, the British are not entirely blameless, but they don't deserve the blame that they're often given for what happened. You know, I hear a lot that, well, that, you know, this was intentional. The British didn't want a powerful India. They wanted two weak states in South Asia because that would somehow help their global strategic position. There's no evidence that bears that out. They really did want the united India. And more than anything else at that point, they just wanted to leave. You know, they it was the Indians who were saying, you know, they couldn't resolve their differences, and the British didn't have the money to stay, they didn't have the will to stay, they didn't have the desire to stay. So they at some point just threw up their hands and decided to go.
Okay.
I don't need to say, I don't know. As a writer, I don't set out to write these, address these. It's just that you get on in the story and then you come across an immovable object, you know, it's like a big rock in the way or something, and you have to try and work out how to deal with it. And when it comes to things like colonialism, I mean, what interests me is when I suddenly see something slightly different. So, you know, colonialism, we tend to think in terms of South Asia, British, and all that. But in other parts of the world, it's a completely different picture. And when, for example, in Portugal, I did some stories that I got very interested in the Portuguese, and it's partly due to the fact that Portuguese are really in Sri Lanka. And, you know, if you have a gathering of people have a discussion there and the word colonialism or imperialism comes up, they're talking about something completely different. You know, they're still talking about the damage or the pride or whatever of the colonialism and an imperialism of the Portuguese Empire. When they talk about empire, that's what comes up in people's minds. And in some of the stories that I've got involved in, I find American colonialism really interesting. You mentioned the Philippines, and again, in that book I mentioned earlier, The Match, part of it is set in the Philippines, because I thought actually the experience there is incredibly interesting, you know, as the American colonial experiment, on one hand. And it's very interesting when you see the remnants of it, you know, the departure of the Americans. Yes, they did leave eventually, but, you know, you go to some of those bases now, and it's a bit like going to the remains of the Roman Empire somewhere, you know, a little amphitheater, it's grown over, things like that. And I find that interesting. Again, in the Philippines, you know, the whole Spanish history, the only Asian country with a Spanish colonial past, and a Catholic one as well. And I wrote another book set in Mauritius, which I found a fascinating area to explore, which is about the competition between the British and the French in the Indian Ocean. And again, going back to a previous panel, we're talking about different voices coming up. And there are stories that just aren't told, aren't heard about, that you discover. And in Mauritius, I think the story of Indian slavery is something that's very, very little written about. So I wrote a book set in 1825, at a time when there was still Indian slavery. And Indian slavery, I mean people who are enslaved and who go through an experience that we are now familiar with in terms of African slavery and the whole transatlantic trade and everything else. Exactly the same thing was happening between India and Mauritius, where plantations were being peopled by people brought in from India. And very, very similar experience, very, very similar ships. But it's a history that's kind of forgotten because it's been overtaken by the history of indentured labor, which is a completely different thing, and in the vast numbers and so on. But I was, again, fascinated by the fact that, you know, in Mauritius was a country where Greenland actually is one of the very few places on the planet where there weren't indigenous people. And therefore, everyone there has arrived and can be dated of their arrival. There's no overlap about it, really. And so that's a very interesting sort of set of layers of history that we can look into. But you know, the way history and colonialism and so on form is really the way it just affects the individual person. And I think in a novel, that's what you're dealing with, individual people. And people who are interesting. Again, there was a really interesting comment that came up in one of the earlier panels about are writers interested in peripheral characters? Are people without voices uninterested in rich people? I think actually the peripheral characters come and go in history in writing throughout the ages, but they're not always central. And you know, it's really the individual that comes. And I think you know the rich and powerful don't have voices either, really. And they come in if they're interested. And I'm interested in the characters who interest me. I like their company. And then I stay with them.
Wonderful. The Philippines, of course, is the one country that is named after a forgotten prince of another country. Perhaps the only such in the world. And of course, in the initial years, they celebrated July the 4th as their independence day. It took a while for them to realize that they need to change that. So they did. But Nury, colonialism.
That's influence on your own. Yeah, actually, I like colonialism. I think we should bring it back. Yay for colonialism. Yeah, we lost so much when we lost colonialism. So, colonialism causes cultures to clash and cross, and it's great. I mean, I particularly like the way the British invent sports that we can defeat them at. I remember we had a discussion about this at a Sri Lankan literary festival, and we had a very high power panel. We had Booker Prize winners, and we had Sri Lanka's top author, who was Arthur C. Clarke. He's not just a, I grew up near him, and we used to call him Arthur Uncle. You know, in Sri Lanka, it's a South Asian university. You just say, Uncle Arthur, Arthur Uncle. And someone asked me, is he my real uncle? I said, no, he's a white guy. He's a British white gay guy. You know why he was in Sri Lanka? Inside story. He accidentally married a woman, realized he was gay, and was hiding in Sri Lanka. True story. But anyway, the conclusion of this panel was that everybody in that room who was super famous and successful had this dual culture experience. All the Booker Prize winners in that room had that dual culture experience. Kiran Desai was there, you know, born in India, moved to America. Arthur C. Clarke, born in the West, moved to the East. They all had this dual thing. So I think this dual point of view is actually very important and very essential. And again, you can see it in the way that we're talking about generally Asian literature in English, and that's the key, in English. It has to be in English to make it to the world stage. That will change eventually, but at the moment, that's the situation. And some of the joy in life, the humor in life, comes from the fact that we try to do everything in English, and you know, some of us are good at it, some of us are not, you know? And there's a sign outside the bridge of my office: dogs should not poop on this walkway. I always carry a graffiti pen, so I have to do, sorry, we cannot read. So I do, they're dogs. It's just an attempt to communicate in English. We all try and do this, and the result is accidental creativity. So colonialism, bring it back.
Boo to that. But anyway, on that note, we have, I think about 7 minutes ago, I got the 2 minute notice. So time's up. I'm going to stop here. Thank you so much.